Let's take a look at some punch stat numbers.
Punch stat gives us a kind of profile of how these fighters fight. And you can see why Whitaker had been so dominant in the lightweight division, throwing and landing many more shots than his opponents. That's a reflection both of his offense and his defense. And here you see how they stack up against each other in terms of how busy they are, roughly the same numbers.
And now the rules of the bout from our ringside unofficial scorer, Harold Lederman. Harold?
Pernell Whitaker and Harold Brazier will fight tonight using the rules of the State Athletic Commission of the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. Three judges scoring the fight on a 10-point must system. The standing eight count is in effect. The three knockdown rule is in effect, and it can be saved by the bell in the last round only. Jim?
All right, let's go up to ring announcer Michael Buffer for pre-fight introductions.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Pennsylvania Hall here at the Civic Center in the city of brotherly love, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, where tonight, Main Events Monitor Productions, in association with Madison Square Garden Boxing and Peltz Boxing Promotions, along with the undisputed, undefeated King of Beer, Budweiser, presents professional boxing for your entertainment. All the bouts tonight are sanctioned by the Pennsylvania State Athletic Commission. The commission has assigned the following officials as judges at ringside. For this bout, they will score on a 10-point must system. They are Lynn Carter, Ron Greenlee, and George Hill. And when the bell rings, the man in charge of the action, referee Frank Cappuccino. And now, ladies and gentlemen, man your battle stations. 10 rounds of boxing. This is in the junior welterweight division. Introducing first, fighting out of the red corner, wearing the blue trunks with gold letters, and weighing in at an even 141 pounds, his overall record, 78 victories with 54 KOs against 10 defeats and one draw. His victory and KO totals at 140 pounds are more than any active fighter in this division in the world today. Ladies and gentlemen, from South Bend, Indiana, the fifth-ranked junior welterweight in the world, Harold Brazier. And his opponent across the ring, fighting out of the blue corner, wearing the black trunks with purple trim, and also weighing in at an even 141 pounds. This 1984 Olympic gold medal champion has a professional record of 27 victories with 13 KOs, only one defeat. He is one of the only two current undisputed champions in the world today. Tonight, he moves up to test the waters at 140 pounds. Ladies and gentlemen, from Norfolk, Virginia, the undisputed champion of the world, Pernell Sweetie Whitaker.
Good evening, gentlemen. I gave you both your instructions. Both just touch gloves, protect yourself at all times. Good luck.
Okay, baby.
One thing I can't shake from my mind, Jim and George, is that we have fighters who are basically similar types of styles depending on their boxing abilities and their quickness. And when you get athletes with similar styles facing each other, it's usually the younger, quicker man who has a much more pronounced edge than you would ordinarily think.
Easy choice, and Harold Brazier himself conceded in discussing the possible strategic matchup in the fight that they are so similar they're likely to mirror each other, and that if all goes according to the way he would like it to go, it might be a dull fight. Not a lot of punches landed.
Think about Harold, he's warmed up. He's got sweat rolling off him before the fight. He's not going to be caught with anything too soon.
You can see that Brazier starts the fight in what amounts to a defensive posture, George, with his upper body leaning back and his weight all on his back foot.
He's going to make Pernell Whitaker reach out and get everything he wants. He's not going to present his body to him. He's going to keep it away.
Pernell landed one low blow, and referee Frank Cappuccino told him from behind, come on, keep him up. Whitaker has been known in the past in his great outings for remarkable accuracy. Particularly with the right jab.
When you spread your legs apart, like Brazier is doing, you don't leave much for the guy to hit. Your body is so far away, and then when you step into him, you're bumping into his knees.
One thing thing about Brazier. He knows how to counter and certainly can do it well. But if his opponent mounts the offensive assault, Brazier is perfectly willing to stand with his hands in the peekaboo posture and just take a bunch of punches without firing back. He likes to wait for his opponent to wear down.
Whittaker is not a true aggressor. He can't keep up for three or four rounds, hitting this guy up against the rope. He can't do it. It's a smart fight Brazier's taken so far. Make Pernell Whittaker come on. Use up your energy, and I'm heavier than anybody that you've ever fought before.
Brazier still in the defensive posture, leaning against the ropes, occasionally firing the jab, but otherwise offering little offense as Pernell tries to figure him out. And it's been a puzzle for Whittaker. He has mostly landed low blows. Now there's a left hand that got through the guard.
Brazier's thinking, sure, he's hitting me a lot, but he can't hurt me. I'm too heavy. I've been at this weight alone for a lot of years.
Right hand lead lands for Brazier. His most effective punch so far. Not a lot of snap behind.
Whittaker's having to avoid bumping into Brazier's knees. Got caught by a good straight hand by Brazier at the time.
Anytime a southpaw faces off against a conventional fighter, and particularly a stand-up fighter like Brazier, you watch their front feet to see which fighter can keep his front foot to the outside. He's likely to gain the advantage in exchanges.
Whittaker's a bit more aggressive than he's been before. This could tell on him in another lot of rounds if this fight goes for any distance.
Well, he was particularly aggressive in his last outing against Paez. Says, I want to put my hands on my opponents a little more.
All right, Harold, you got a good look at him now. You got to go to work and you got to get your punches off. You can double up on that left jab when he's coming in. Don't just paw it out there and leave it hanging. You can double up, snappy left jab. Good feints to hold him off balance. When he comes in and throws them shots and you block him, bam, right back. You got to counter right now.
Bam, bam, with something real big. Just keep him honest. But just keep that jab going. Keep it going. Keep it going. You can't do nothing with it. But every now and then, two or three big ones on him. Because he can't handle you inside. He doesn't want to do with you. So not just fight him out of the post, but not don't smother yourself, you know? But just stay right there. Wing it, right? And then bang, bang, and then bang.
Good
bang,
eyes
hard,
in
hard, hard.
Stay in your corner. Stay, both of you stay in the corner.
Sweet Pea Whittaker has undergone a really interesting change and evolution in his life as a fighter. When we first saw him in the Olympics and after the Olympics, he was running around the ring like he could do it all day and all night, and he could. And here he is, standing straight up, looking right in the eye of the storm, willing to exchange punches.
When you think about it, his corner, Whittaker's corner, has told him to go bang, bang with heavy shots. That may not be the smartest thing to do in this heavier division. To me, the most important thing is to stay ahead on points.
Well, they didn't put Whittaker in with a noted knockout puncher. Even though Brazier has 54 knockouts in his 78 wins, he is not regarded as a one-punch knockout type and not regarded as the kind of guy who could be a short-range danger to Pernell Whittaker. He'd have to pile up a lot of punishment on Pernell to knock him out.
But I think if Pernell Whittaker reaching out, trying to land hard shots, can run into a good straight right, he'll be getting him off the canvas if he's not careful.
Let him out.
Not because Brazier's a harder puncher, but because you can just run into it and hurt yourself.
And Pernell is again demonstrating that he wants to be aggressive, wants to make the fight.
Come on.
Coming forward, standing and trading much, much more, as Larry Merchant points out, than was the case earlier in his career.
Brazier hasn't decided to look at Whittaker as an ordinary fighter
loose.
Yet.
Get them hands loose.
Once he decides, hey, this guy's no more than anyone else, this could be a tough fight.
Brazier has shifted his weight just a little bit now, beginning to put a little bit more weight on his front foot.
Yeah, you notice the legs are coming closer together, which, if I was he, I'd keep him apart just a bit longer to let Whittaker take some of the steam out of his punches.
Good left hand inside by Pernell Whittaker. Stopped Brazier in his tracks for a second. Harold trying to go to the body with the right hand.
Previously, Whitaker had
to get him loose,
step around those long legs to get inside with a body shot. But now those legs are not so long, they're closing up. He's able to get good body shots.
Let him go, Harold. Let him go, Harold.
Good body punch by Harold Brazier.
Harold expressed to us in a meeting that he thought he could land right hands to the body, and he got a left hand in there, countering Pernell Whitaker over the top of the right. As we go back to the corners, almost all of the bell in Pernell Whitaker's corner is done by former Philadelphia middleweight George Benton. The man who speaks to Harold Brazier is his manager, Pete Susan.
All right, Harold, wasn't bad, but you're holding back too much.
I'm timing a little bit.
I know, you're thinking a little too much now. Okay, that's too old for him. You can let your punches flow in combination, threes and fours, especially when he's in close with you. Mix them up, following and up. All right, on the outside, use that tap.
Use him on, hit him on the shoulders. Hit him on the shoulders with your dead weight. Hit him on the hip with your dead weight. Reach and hit him on, you know, on the sit-down part. With that dead weight, right? Double up on your left hooks, right?
Just the fucker.
But a man cannot handle the inside, so that's what he wants.
Watch Whitaker's right hand. Watch his jab. Perfect straight jab. Something will come behind it before long. Incidentally, that's the first time I've ever heard a manager tell a fighter early in the fight, you're behind 2-0. He's trying to rouse his fighter into a more offensive fight.
Trying to tell him to go out and get some more points. Still here. This could be a great mistake by Whitaker, throwing away his power in the earlier rounds against a bigger guy. Brazier has big legs, big thighs.
Well, one thing Pernell Whitaker wanted to do here was to be busy early and not to allow Brazier to get raised. So far, Pernell has been throwing 100 punches per round. That's a high volume, and it's aimed at keeping Harold Brazier back on his heels in a defensive posture. Left hand lands over the top for Whitaker, and look at all the leather he's trying to throw inside.
Keep him loose, man.
Whitaker's starting to fall forward even now. That weight difference is already starting to show a bit. Good body punch by Pernell Whitaker.
Whitaker throwing 4 or 5 punches to every one from Brazier.
Let him go, let him go.
Remains to be seen if Pernell can keep up the pace, fighting at a higher weight than before.
And when you throw those punches at a higher weight, it's like wind sprinting. Sure, you do it, but afterwards you ought to win from them.
We should point out, this isn't the first time that Pernell has ever been in the ring at 140 pounds. He has actually fought at this weight before, but he was an overweight lightweight when he did that. This is the first time he's been there, meaning to stay at this weight.
It was said earlier, today could be the first day of the rest of his life.
Brazier's starting to find some business coming up and under. He landed 2 uppercuts. And another one to the body.
Whitaker allows Brazier to get some courage.
Let him go, P. Let him go.
Now you saw Brazier get his leg outside of Whitaker's there, pin Pernell inside, and hit him twice to the body. Again, whichever fighter is able to keep his foot to the outside of the other has the advantage in these exchanges. Solid left hand and right hand from Pernell Whitaker.
As I said earlier, it's like running wind sprints. It takes so much out of you at that weight.
You're watching the continued evolution of Pernell Whitaker from one-time will-o'-the-wisp to dangerous, aggressive body puncher.
Three or four rounds, Whitaker's going to realize, hey, this is not going to be a cakewalk. You're going to fight this guy.
Pernell just cut loose and tried to flatten Harold Brazier with a left hand. Wasn't able to catch him slow. There's a right hand by Brazier in a counter that landed and and coming up, following this 10-round non-title fight, Our main event of the evening is the championship bout. Meldrick Taylor defending his WBA welterweight belt against hard-punching Glenwood Brown. There is a look at the hometown Philadelphia fighter, Meldrick Taylor, as he warms up amid the friendly support of his camp.
And here's Pernell Whitaker on your left playing a tune on his opponent. I get the feeling I'm watching somebody give a little piano recital here.
Straight and easy left.
And what's amazing about it really is that Pernell Whitaker is standing there inside the eye of what could be a storm, and yet he really isn't a hard puncher. He's boxing in a way that Georgie Benton would be proud of. Georgie Benton himself is a boxer, and perhaps Pernell Whitaker is his ultimate creation here.
He's starting to make sounds around Brazier's body, Pernell Whitaker is, just to make him drop his hand a little bit for an easy shot. Brazier seems to be a bit too smart for that.
Right hand lands for Brazier, but again, Whitaker is dealing out much more than he's taking, throwing three and four and sometimes five punches to every one by Brazier.
Earlier, Brazier kept his feet apart. He kept Pernell Whitaker off balance. If he continues to do that, things can happen. But if he closes those legs up, Whitaker is going to go off with several combinations.
Cut landed for Whitaker and excited the crowd.
Be cool, please. Be cool.
Brazier's trying to make Whitaker commit for a hard shot. But at the same time, he's getting him with short, snappy shots.
Brazier hasn't lost a fight since he was knocked out by Rasai Bramble back in 1989, the former Livingstone Bramble. He was still hampered in that fight by a rotator cuff injury that he had suffered in his title shot against Juan Koji. It's been 2.5 years since he's lost.
Brazier's no doubt the harder, heavier-handed tonight. He keeps waiting for one shot. He won't get it tonight. It's going to have to be done in combination. Whitaker's not going to go down with one shot.
Whitaker, of course, faced hard punches in the lightweight division from time to time. He has been knocked down in his career by the likes of Roger Mayweather and Rafael Williams.
Sometimes when you're in the heavier weights and you throw those punches going forward, I liken it to throwing a bowling ball with a string on your arm.
Let him out. Let him go, Harold. Let him go, Harold, from you.
Even though you land, you're still.
Come on. Keep it straight.
Referee Frank Cappuccino warning Brazier against holding Whitaker. And Whitaker winds up the round with 7 or 8 punches dealt out. Only one in return from Brazier.
Come on, you're boxing beautifully. You're boxing beautifully.
Too much of an angle on it. Getting too much of an angle on it. Got to step to your left a little bit. Keep it from getting too far over, all right?
Four rounds in the books now in this 10-round fight.
Go the other way.
So we're almost halfway through.
He's in there letting them combination.
And Harold, how do you have it scored?
Jim, 40-36, 4-0, favorite Pernell Whitaker. Jim, these two guys are standing on a dime. You could put a phone booth in that ring, and they stay in a phone booth all night. They're standing in the middle of the ring, and Pernell Whitaker's just out banging him. I mean, he's landing the cleaner, more aggressive shots, and he's just catching my eye with the cleaner punches.
And here's another virtuoso combination by Whitaker. A left, a right, followed by a right uppercut. I get the feeling I'm just watching a naturally gifted athlete against a manufactured fighter. The guy who has to study everything And therefore, he's not as quick and as loose when he throws his punches.
I find Brazier knows too much, if you ask me.
Meaning what, George?
He's thinking about doing a lot of things and not doing anything at this point, but being hit. Of course, Whitaker's not the hard of punches, but he can get you swelling up if you keep letting him tap your face.
Well, I think that makes a good point. Whitaker looks more comfortable against a conventional boxer like Brazier than he did against wild, less polished fighters like Poli Diaz and Jorge Baez.
That gets to the point I made just before the fight, Jim. Fighters have vaguely or closely resembling styles. The quicker guy is going to have a tremendous margin, and I agree with Carol Letterman that Pernell Whitaker is pitching a shutout right now.
And throwing a lot of pitches. 110 punches thrown in round number four. Brazier, at 73 punches, was busy by conventional standards. But Pernell is just swamping him with action.
He's thinking that he's going to knock Whitaker out with one shot.
Let him out.
And Whitaker is thinking maybe I'll hit him three as he waits.
Well, as you look at the 140-pound weight class, you suspect that it isn't going to take Pernell Whitaker long to attract a title shot. Solid right hand by Brazier as Pernell temporarily went to sleep and just stood still and took it.
Maybe he was thinking about the junior welterweight champions also at that moment, Jim, just as you were.
Great mind. The three titles in the division are held by Edwin Rosario of Puerto Rico, Rafael Pineda of Colombia, and the great Julio Cesar Chavez of Mexico.
The thing about Brazier, he uses his eyes well. Size it up. He doesn't like to throw wasted punches.
Left hand lead landed for Whitaker after Brazier threw the right.
When sometimes you ought to throw six or seven, wherever they land or not, just keep the guy off balance.
Left and a right, both solid by Whitaker. Brazier tries to answer and lands a right hand.
Hey, right out, fellas. Come on. Now look. Let's knock it off, okay? With the back, and you knock it off when I say break. Let's go.
As I said earlier, Whitaker is vicious. He does things that are really mean.
Well, he's never been above trying to embarrass his opponents.
Come on, Pete.
But he's never really had the capacity to hurt them. Maybe he wants to develop that. Coming up later on in the evening, our main event is a championship fight. Meldrick Taylor, the WBA World Welterweight Champion, will put that title on the line against Glenwood Brown, a former Madison Square Garden star who has moved out of the garden to get his chances at a welterweight championship, and miraculously enough, gets a second title shot tonight, just about 3.5 months after having lost his first chance at a title against Maurice Blocker. Blocker is in the audience tonight. He got the benefit of a split decision against Glenwood Brown last fall, but almost everyone who saw the fight believes should have been a unanimous decision.
Okay.
Hey, look this way.
Now here's the punch that Brazier threw in and fired his best punch of the fight. And it didn't hurt Whitaker, which is bad news for Brazier.
He waited all night for that one shot.
That was the moment when Whitaker was listening to me talking about his upcoming title shots in the 140-pound class.
Whitaker's starting to jab to the body, which means he's going to open up to the head.
Well, as Larry has pointed out, George, this is the kind of night that George Benton loves because Pernell has a terrific target here on which to practice some of his more conventional boxing arts, and there was a great left hand flush on the face, and he drives Brazier into the ropes.
It's like he's at a candy store. He doesn't know what to reach for. Landing so many different things.
There they are, right under the net.
We'll be back in the corner for the second fight, taking care of Meldrick Taylor. Another prize student is Evander Holyfield.
Whitaker's starting to open up with the power that's starting to hurt. Brazier.
Yeah, Brunel's getting braver and committing himself a little more to each punch, George.
It's like he's, I said, I don't think he knows how to be a Fred Brunel Whitaker.
He's a young man who exudes self-confidence. In a sport where so many fighters like to be surrounded by people all the time and don't seem comfortable unless they're surrounded by people, you often find Purnell alone, sitting in his room alone, touring the hotel alone. He doesn't need people around him.
Tells you he likes himself. Probably likes his style of boxing, which is pretty good tonight.
My boat is tied. Let him out. Let him out. Let him out.
He's actually muscling his heavier guy up against the corner. As if to say, you can't get
him. All right, stop punching, both of you.
This is something Brazier didn't expect at all.
Come on, Brunel. Now, look, I'm not going to tell you again. Next time I have to tell you, I'm going to take a point off you. Let's go, man.
Brunel is unimpressed with Frank Cappuccino's judgments of his low blows.
He's got Brazier reaching out at him now. He's like one of those comfortable beds that goes up and down now. Anything he wants, he can make him do.
Walked into a Brazier right hand. The Gander didn't bother him all that much. Making Brazier pay to the body.
And clipping him with right hooks. He's starting to thread it. A needle with a straight left hand now.
Brazier trying to go to the body, but through round six, it's another outstanding performance by Purnell Whitaker.
Brazier to the body and then you gotta keep it up. All right? You gotta keep it up. You've got to dig inside the combination.
Pulls the eyes.
Fives and sixes. Now, five, you gotta put them together now. You can't, you're waiting yourself out of this fight. You understand that? Go in behind the jab.
Come up,
okay,
man.
All right. Now listen, go around him. As long as you can see, so when you're going around this guy in the circle, it's wearing him to death. Now, remember that. When you're close to him, all you got to do is take steps around. I don't give a damn how close you are to him. Around, around. Don't go back this way, right? But keep your hands moving.
Right on time.
And there's the low blow that, if it's repeated, could cost Whitaker a point, perhaps the only point he would lose in this fight. You know, Philadelphia's two best-known boxing purists of recent decades are both here, Benton and Harold Johnson, the former light heavyweight champion. I used to urge Teddy Brenner, the famous matchmaker of Madison Square Garden, to use Johnson more, and why didn't he? And he said, Harold Johnson is the nearest thing to perfection in the ring, and there's no room for perfection in boxing. Because what we're seeing here tonight is virtual perfection and no drama. And that's what the matchmaker was concerned about.
Whitaker has taken a hard fight, a dangerous fight, and made it look easy.
Really has, and the only drama is developing in Brazier's corner, where you heard manager Pete Susan say to his fighter, you are waiting yourself right out of the fight. He wants Brazier to open up and take a few more chances. That's much easier said than done, isn't it, George?
I can tell you this. It's a shutout. Whitaker, for the first couple of rounds, was kind of hesitant. He was afraid, but now he's like, hey, I own this ring.
The trouble with opening up and taking chances against a guy like Brunel is that he's so quick, counters so effectively, and is so accurate with his punches. He makes you pay every time.
This could have been a point early on, but he's been hit with so many good body punches around to the side, and his punches will be ineffective from this point on.
Meaning Brazier.
Brazier's punches will be ineffective at this point. Too many body punches.
I think we may be getting close to a possible TKO. There are moments here when Brazier is just not trading back and taking a lot of punish.
Whitaker is so mean that sometimes he doesn't even try to get a knockout. He'll just beat you up for a few. Not only Whitaker wants Chavez, Chavez, and he wants to get out there and show everybody, not only am I tough in the lighter weights, I can move up. I've got punching power.
Get it over with.
Of course, a lot of people want to get at Julio Cesar Chavez, and that, too, is easier said than done. Chavez, for the moment, controlled by promoter Don King, has not been in the ring with either Meldrick Taylor or any of his other primary adversaries at 140 pounds since the spring of 1990.
Whitaker's putting on a great exhibition.
Stop punching both of you.
Chavez could be passing up a great career.
Boy, Purnell is just having a field day here in round number 7. His best round so far, a nightmare for Harold Brazier, who trades back little, if at all.
He just didn't expect Whitaker to have that much power.
Now.
And as you walk, Harold Brazier walking
round.
Back to his
see,
corner for the first
right
time, he looks
right
every bit of his 36 years old.
Same thing. Just don't get careless and don't get cheap. And that's boxing. That's boxing that side. You understand? That's what you're doing.
Hi, Hippie. You're boxing beautiful out there, baby. See? See that jab? You're touching with that jab. You're hitting that double jab. Come on. And then work your way in.
That's it. Look. You see how the chip is wearing him together? See, you ain't got to tell me he's touching.
You know, Whitaker's having a field day. Anything he sees, he can do.
Watch, good uppercut. Watch this. 6 punches.
Huh?
3 of them landed.
Wait a minute, fellas. Wait a minute.
Now they're ready to begin round 8. Well, you saw the punch stat numbers between rounds that indicated Harold Brazier landed only 5 blows in the 7th round.
At this point, Whitaker is so confident, he may even drop his hand and play games. Good body punch, bud.
Temporarily knocked Brazier off balance, didn't it, George?
Whitaker is going to be a good fighter in that weight class because he has the power. Not to knock you off, but to hurt you and stun you.
Yeah, but the great fighters in the division, first and foremost Chavez, but also Pineda and Rosario do have the power to knock you out.
Now that makes a lot of sense.
This again, Brazier not trading anything back. Purnell just whacking away.
Whitaker was stunned momentarily, but he just doesn't seem to mind being hit.
Brazier has gotten increasingly wobbly in the last 2 rounds.
The thing about Brazier, you've got to end your combinations with a right hand when you're fighting a southpaw. He's ending with lefts.
Why do you have to end it with a right hand, George?
Because that's the punch that's going to keep the guy off balance.
Come on.
A right hand. It's like you're jabbing with your right hand. The left hand keeps the opposite off balance. Just the right
hand. Take Harold's glove up when he comes back.
Frank Cappuccino telling Brazier's corner to tape his glove up between rounds. Brazier's starting to get a little more aggressive again. Perhaps sensing that time is running out.
Let him go, Pink.
The thing about Whitaker, he's never finished fights real strong.
Come on, keep it straight, hey? Keep it straight, man.
That's an old Purnell trick, grabbing his opponent around the waist and throwing him off balance.
That's what I want, I know it is.
Doesn't want to let him get away with it. Of course, the referees know Purnell, and they know what he's likely to do.
At this time, Purnell Whitaker better be a little more careful because he is not the master of the 10th, 11th, and 12th round.
This fight scheduled for 10 rounds only. Purnell's lightweight title's not on the line. And of course, so far he doesn't look like he's in danger of losing anything. Brazier is doubling over in pain. The body punching has done its deed. And now as they settle down between rounds 8 and 9 here, we think of WBA World Welterweight Champion Meldrick Taylor in the dressing room. Meldrick, are you getting a chance to enjoy your stablemate's performance here?
Putter looks superb. He's doing what he got to do. He's boxing, put on the boxing lesson in the clinic.
Do you think that he'll have to exhibit a little more punching power to have a chance to win a title in that division?
I don't think so. I think Putter have no power for the junior welterweights here. If you're going over this type of style.
It's been awfully difficult for you to get Julio Cesar Chavez back into the ring with you. Are you rooting for Purnell to get a first crack at him now?
Well, that's Chavez's choice.
Indeed it is. All right, thanks very much. We'll see you later on, Meldrick.
All right.
He called it a technical fight, and it is. But spectators don't pay to read textbooks.
That's what they're saying.
In the last round, Whitaker threw 90 punches. Brazier landed a total of 12.
And so that's no reflection, I should add, on Whitaker. If he's got the right opponent, we could see a real action fight with him now, the way he is fighting. Any one of the champions who fights him could give him a real problem, especially Chavez and perhaps Pineda as well. And when he's fighting this flat-footed.
So you agree with George, Larry, that there's been a significant transformation in Whitaker over his last half dozen or so fights.
Well, there's no doubt about it. There's no doubt about it.
He's willing to stand and trade punches and with who. It doesn't matter what they weigh.
And other master boxers have done the same. Sugar Ray Robinson did the same. Many master boxers early in their career depended on their foot speed, and gradually they settled down.
Ray Leonard, another example.
Started to slap him with his right hand that time. These are the kind of punches that hurt your hand. Slapping them, you're throwing a lot of power, but you're not pointing your fist. Back,
is it a mark of fatigue?
Sometimes of overconfident, wanting to land a punch without looking first.
Of course, Brunell has had trouble with his hands in the past.
You can believe he's going to have to soak them in ice tonight.
One of the impressive things about Whitaker is doing, guys, is this. Boxers, pure boxers, generally will fight far less than 3 minutes a round. It takes a different kind of mental conditioning and physical conditioning to fight like this and throw as many punches. And so it's more than just a stylistic change. It's a change that goes from deep within you to be able to do this.
And it's quite a message to future opponents to know that this is a guy who can come in and throw punches, all of them with spirited intentions, for 36 straight minutes.
Could be a message to the boxing world in general. Hey, you pay all these big heavyweights all that money. Look at me. I'm much better. Look at me. Just look at me. That statement he's trying to make. Or middleweights. Maybe you want a $6-8 million purse.
Well, of course, we've been giving the public a chance to look at Purnell Whitaker here on HBO for 3.5 years. And what they've seen is the increasing maturation of a young man who's always been regarded as a great fighter, but is now being seen as a different one than was the case a year ago.
He's having a field day, and this is a great, good boxer he's fighting.
One round to go.
Thought yourself out of this one, Harold. Don't get down on yourself. You got 3 minutes to win it. You came here to win it. And you better go out there and do every damn thing you can do to do it. You understand? All right?
Look, listen. Don't go out there doing nothing spectacular. Just do what you've been doing. You're going to win this fight just like you did. All right?
That jab is working beautiful. Just double up that jab. Jab and turn.
The last round. Okay. This is the last round.
You just do it just like that, right?
You can't win the fucking fight. So get out there and go.
Round,
come on.
You
got to hustle up and do
it.
Forget about technique.
Get loose.
Forget about what he's going to do. Forget about any bullshit like that and fight.
Don't wait to see what he's going to do. Let him fly, Harold. Let him fly.
And final round.
Harold, one round to go. How do you have it scored?
Preno, Whitaker. Preno's doing all the punching. He should win easily.
So you've got him winning all nine rounds, Harold?
All nine rounds, Jim. Absolutely a shout-out.
Brazier's corner told him to forget about technique. Get out there and win this fight. He tried for a minute.
Told him in no uncertain terms.
And he's right. Time out for jabbing and counterpunching. It's time to just fight. Fight. Win this thing in three minutes or less.
Well, all of Harold Brazier's movements in the ring show you, as Larry has pointed out, that he is made, not born as a fighter. Self-made. It's remarkable that a man could enter the sport at age 24 and become the kind of polished boxer that Harold Brazier is. But he never had the natural gifts that make Pernell Whitaker different.
Whitaker's starting to show his footwork. Brazier's going after the guy, but occasionally it's like running into a bolt of lightning. That's the viciousness I told you.
Well, except he didn't step in and whack him when Brazier was standing still there and seemingly defenseless. I think Pernell looks as though he's getting a little bored with this. So he's playing around, and I'm sure that Benton and Duval will tell him sometime after the fight that that wasn't the world's best idea. Okay. Brazier at this point is simply taking too much punishment to have a chance to take advantage of it. Pernell almost fell down.
Almost fell down. You said it right. Still a lot of movement. He's playing tricks with his feet. Knows he has the fight won. His corner didn't even tell him to go out there and get a knockout. Keep boxing.
The crowd is looking forward to seeing Meldrick Taylor and Glenwood Brown. They have a pretty clear picture of who's won this fight. And poor Harold Brazier was able to give his manager, Pete Susans, about 30 seconds of sincere effort before Pernell Whitaker put him back in jail.
Come on, let him out. Come on, fighters are holding. Come on, you're...
Rocky in particular.
Yeah, Rocky came back. Right here in Philly.
High break.
That wasn't nice.
Junior welterweight, he can do it.
Yep.
Pernell Whitaker has proven to the world. The crowd just don't like textbook.
Well, the crowd wasn't entertained unless they were tourists, but there are a lot of tourists here in Philadelphia.
But those people who are booing Larry are booing for exactly the same reason that Teddy Brenner didn't want to put Harold Johnson in the ring at Madison Square Garden, right?
Perfection.
You win a baby, you win.
As a new
perfection can get a little boring sometimes if you're looking for blood and guts. Speaking of perfection, let's look at Harold Letterman's final call.
Well, Jim, thank you very much. I didn't really think it was a difficult fight to score. I had it 100-90, 10 rounds to nothing, favor of Pernell Whitaker. I think he was just too busy, did all the punching. I thought the closest Harold Brazier came to winning a round was possibly in the 10th round, where Pernell Whitaker looked like he was going to go down. But even still, Pernell took it away from him and won that round. A shout-out for Whitaker.
You agree, George?
I can tell you this. Pernell Whitaker wanted not only to win this fight, but prove that he can go the distance, go to the goal, anything. All the things he did as a...
I tell you, Bill, go ahead. Tell him what you were saying now. Tell him what you were saying now. Go ahead. Go ahead. Tell him what you were saying now.
The shy and retiring Lou Duva has Pernell lean out of the ring to chat with the ultimate Philadelphian, former Temple University football star Bill Cosby.
Bill Cosby's going to make a comeback.
Bill Cosby doesn't need to make a comeback. He's never left. Let's go to ring announcer Michael Buffer for the official decision.
Ladies and gentlemen, here is the official scoring. Lynn Carter scores about 190. That's the same score from Ron Greenlee, 190. And George Hill scores at 191 for the winner by unanimous decision.
Come on, let's go.
Brunel, Sweet Pea, Whitaker.
So two judges had the same shutout as Harold Lederman, and one judge gave Brazier the benefit of one even round. And we look at final punch stat numbers. You'll see that Whitaker threw almost exactly 100 punches per round, landed only 32% of them. He's been up well above 40% in several fights, but Brazier's a pretty good defensive fighter. He was able only to throw 618 punches, and that's a big enough difference right there to account for the victory for Whitaker, who stands by now with Larry Merchant. All right.